Shall we start? Everybody is here? So I will finish this lecture, this one, the second lecture, on the entropy production. As I told you, this is not very useful for what I am going to do, but it is useful to a better understanding of all the phenomena. So entropy is a function of state. So if you know pressure, temperature, and composition of the system, you know the entropy, because this is a function of state. So you know the entropy. So the entropy, as I will show you, is not a conserved quantity. It's not a conserved scalar at all. It has a term of flux and a term of production. And according to the second law of thermodynamics, when the system is isolated, that is, when the system has no flux across its boundary, the entropy increases. You know that the entropy of an isolated system should increase. This is the second law of thermodynamics. All right? And I tried now to see what are the mechanisms responsible for that. So to do that, you have to start with thermodynamic relations, okay, expressing the entropy in terms of the internal energy, the work, and the mu here is the potential of a particle species I, and yi is the mass fraction of species. This is known as a thermodynamic relation. Okay? Now, for an ideal gas law, this is a form of the entropy in terms of pressure and density. Okay? This is expression, but okay. Now, if I know this from this expression here, thermodynamic relation here, I immediately obtain the balance using the Lagrangian form or the particulate derivative of S. I replace that by delta. Delta here gives you the particulate derivative of the thermal energy. This delta V is the delta over 1 over rho here, and this. And now, if I use the expression of the balance of internal energy, the continuity equation for the volume, and the conservation and the evolution equation for each species, I obtain a form for the form of the entropy balance, and I got not only the flux but also the production term, and the production term is written here in that form. That form looks complicated, but you see, it's all the time it is the gradient of a intensive quantity. Here it is the temperature inverse. This here is the chemical potential, and here is a stress tensor. So you obtain immediately a general form of the production of entropy, which is the equivalent of the diffusion flux in terms of the gradient of the intensive quantity which is associated to this flux. For example, you see to the heat flux, you have associated you have associated the gradient of temperature. One has to be careful with the sign. Yeah? And for example, if I use a one-dimensional in one-dimensional geometry, and if I put this expression of the tensor here, the viscous tensor, I obtain this form here for the production of entropy. I have neglected the diffusion flux. I assume, for example, for simplicity, that it is there is no reaction. If you want, I have suppressed the reaction, and I have assumed that I have only one component, one species in the flow. So now this term here takes this form and should be positive. But because it should be positive, this tells you that the viscosity here and the conductivity here, heat conductivity, should be positive because all these quantities are squared. So this is the reason, essential reason, why you have a diffusion equation with a positive diffusion coefficient, and this gives you a relaxation mechanism, as I showed you in my previous slide, okay? So this, and it is interesting to see that this, it can be written in two other different ways that I have written here, that you may find in the literature. And you know, I have written here putting on the left hand side rho ds of dt. Here I have put on the right hand side rho t ds of dt. Why did I do that? Because you know that in the thermodynamics course, you use T times the variation of entropy. Delta Q is T times the variation of entropy. And another reason why I have used this, and you know, these two expressions are here. And why did I write this? This is because in the lecture of tomorrow, I am going to talk about the internal structure of a shock wave, a weak shock wave. And the first work was developed by a Scottish man called Rankin. And he used, in fact, when you read carefully the paper of Rankin, it is not easy to read this kind of paper because they use a vocabulary very strange. They call S the potential. So when you read that, what potential is it? In fact, it is the entropy. But at that time of Rankin, the entropy was not well developed. And he used this form, and this form is very useful to understand the structure of a detonation. Okay, now I go to the, I think it is finished. Yes, I go to the next lecture. So don't be afraid too much by all this equation. For those who are not familiar with this equation, because I will try to use the simple form of this equation. So my third lecture is, it is a wonderful lecture, not because I am giving this lecture. It's a wonderful lecture because it is the masterpiece of work that has been developed almost more than 60 years ago, and that explains flames. Really, it's a fascinating work. This work was developed by a man called Zeldovich. Let me tell you this simple story of this. I met him once in my life. He was a fabulous man. You know, he did this work, he was less than 30, you know, your age. You know? Yeah. And doing this work, in fact, he invented a new method for solving singular problems. He was not at all a mathematician. Yes, no degree. Yes, no degree at university degree. This man developed his mother was cleaning the lab, and she was widow, without husband, widow, and she brought his small kids with it was in Russia at the period of Russia was. An interesting country. So she brought her kid in the lab, and very soon, the scientist in this lab noticed that this man has something special, you know, sometimes some genius like that. And so he never got a university degree. He learned everything because the scientist explained to him the physics and so on. So this man was really very fantastic. Okay, and let me tell you that most of the theoretical works, and even maybe numerical, maybe we will see that, are based on this analysis. The present works, you know, the present work, analytical work, are based on the analysis. And one more point, it took this work was written in 1938. I start in 1970. At that time, very few people, and I can say zero people, nobody, understand this work. It took 30 years to understand the work. My challenge is to make you understand this work easily. You tell me the result after the... I will see. Okay. The first point is, you know, the fascinating aspect of conversion is, as I told you, is to be this systematic reduction of complexity that leads you to an overall understanding of the phenomena. This is something, for example, which is not yet developed, for example, in the life science. Not yet. For example, a model in life science, it is difficult to have a model that you can understand easily in mathematical terms. And if something is not understood in mathematical terms, means that it is not understood at all. Okay? Almost. Yeah, this is a little bit too tough, okay? But I think that it is not so bad. All right. So we will use a very simple model, one-step irreversible reaction. You cannot imagine a more simple model for that. And we will use the Arrhenius law I have described in my first lecture for the reaction rate. And the genius of Zelovich was to push the nonlinearity of this law up to its singular limit. I will explain you. Say like that, it looks very difficult to understand, but you will see it is not. Okay. So first of all, I have to show you what is called the quasi-isobaric approximation, which is, in fact, now in fluid mechanics, as the low Mach number approximation. You know, if this is an Euler equation, this Euler equation without the time derivative term here, gives you an order of magnitude of the variation of the pressure. You see, if you take out this grad here, you have delta P is rho U du, delta U, okay? This is give you an order of magnitude. But P, the order of magnitude of P is rho times the square of the sound speed. You know, P is okay. Now, if you look to delta P over P now, using a delta U of the order of U, just to have an idea, you obtain the Mach number square. But as I show you that the Mach number square for a flame is something like 10 minus 4, 10 minus 6, minus 5. It's very small. So now if you assume that the evolution is also slow, that it is slower than the propagation of acoustics, this is a little bit more difficult to understand. Maybe I will be back to that. And if you assume now that you are very subsonic, that the Mach number that you are dealing with is very small, oh, my goodness. This term, dp, the relative pressure, variation of the pressure, should be much smaller than the relative rate of variation of the temperature, because this delta T over T is of order unity, because you go from 300K to 2000K. So this term should be dp over dt should be negligible in front of the thermal. So in the energy equation, in open space, you have to be careful if you are in a closed space, like in an engine. In an engine, when you are in closed space, when the flame propagates, you increase the pressure, the overall pressure in a almost uniform way. Okay? But here, if you are in not open space, this term disappears. So now you have only the thermal equation, which is that you obtain in the low Mach number approximation, is that the Lagrangian derivative of the temperature is related to the thermal flux plus the heat release. No pressure effect. This is the term which is used, the term which is used to describe this is to say that there is no compressible effect. But be careful. No compressible effect means no acoustic waves. In a sense, the acoustics are infinitely fast, so they are too fast, and they equalize the pressure. All right? But this does not mean that there is no density change. You have density change in combustion, because in flame, because pressure is proportional to density time temperature. Temperature change of order unity, so density is change of order unity. So when you say, when we say, no, which is not a, when one say it is, there is no compressible effect, this does not mean that the density is constant. It means that the acoustic waves are negligible. All right? This is very important. If you have understood, that today, this, good day. Now, it is very interesting to notice that the two equations, the thermal equation and the species conservation equation, are quite similar. They are all balanced by a diffusion term. One is the heat conductivity, the other is the molecular. And there is a rate consumption or production rate, which comes from the chemical energy. Chemical energy for the temperature, mass coming from the reaction rate. Yeah. So I have written here that in detail, introducing the stoichiometric coefficient. Forget about that. I will simplify that even more. Now, in the reference frame of a planar flame, as I told you, I am going to study the structure of a planar flame. And as I told you also, planar flame, difficult to exist, but we have to start with this. So if you work in the, assume that the solution has a meaning, work in the reference frame of the flame, okay? Now in that case, the material derivative time rho is m. M is the mass flux, which is conserved across the flame, and times the space derivative if I work in the reference frame of the flame. And now you replace this material derivative by this space derivative, you end up with equation that are very similar, that are second order ordinary differential equations for temperature and spaces. Very similar equations, except that the diffusion coefficient may be different, which is not so much the case, but it plays a role, and except that the reaction rate here are modulated by a different quantity. One is the mass, and the other is the chemical energy. You see? That's very simple. Now, here are the boundary conditions. You give, okay, M is unknown, because if you know M, you know the flame speed. Because in the reference frame of the flame, the flow enters with the speed of propagation of the flame in the quiescent medium. Okay? This is just a change of frame, of reference. All right? This is okay? Is there a problem here? Everybody understands that? No. Am I clear or not? Yes, okay. I am happy because for a teacher, you know, there is nothing worse to speak and that people does not understand a word, you know. This sometimes occurs, and many times. And so, now you have boundary condition. Boundary condition, I put the fresh mixture on the left, so x minus infinity. You know the temperature, you know the composition, and you assume that the reaction rate is zero, that you are frozen. It is not zero because you are at equilibrium, not at all. You are not at equilibrium. But the time to get to equilibrium is infinite. So zero reaction rate. This you are, we say we are, the state is frozen. In the burned gas, the situation is different. The reaction rate, the global reaction rate, is zero. It does not mean, in fact, they are balanced both on one direction and the reverse are balanced. The global reaction are zero. There is no evolution of species because you are at equilibrium. This is because you are at equilibrium. And now the burn gas temperature, the composition can be obtained in a full system by assuming equilibrium composition. And this is not so easy to do. Eh? You have to use numerical code because you know, all these chemical reactions are complicated. But for me, I will simplify the thing. But this is the general formulation, and you say that the boundary condition here, that the temperature is uniform. Okay, you could have said the same thing for the mass fraction, in fact. But in fact, it turns out that the mass fraction is related to the temperature, so by the equilibrium. But okay, we may skip this detail. Go to this simple now scheme used by Zeldovich. A reactant is decomposed in a product and release heat. I will call Y the mass fraction of the reactant. So I put everything in a neutral species, for example, nitrogen, neutral. So I have a reactant. This reactant, now here I have only one reaction. So because I have only one reaction, I have only one reaction rate. Capital W here, dot W. And I will use here the energy released per unit mass of reactant here. Okay, it's better to use this one. M, mass flux is unknown, which gives you the flame, gives you the flame velocity. And now here are the boundary condition. At infinity, you know the mass fraction of R that there is in your medium. So you know the quantity of reactant that you have in your neutral. You know that. It's called YU. U is for unburned. Okay? It is because the reaction is irreversible here. In the burned gas, it should be zero. Okay, no problem. And you know the temperature also in the initial mixture, and you have to add here that the gradient of temperature should be zero on the burned gas, because I assume that there is no heat loss and so on. We will be back to this problem later. Now, if you you know, what you can do is to introduce, you may integrate this equation from minus infinity to plus infinity, all right? This term goes down because it is the integral gives you the difference of the flux in the fresh mixture and in the burn mixture. Both of them are zero because you are uniform. So you are left with this integral of that, and this is because y equals zero in the burn gas. This is simply m yu, where yu is the mass fraction in the initial mixture. Okay, now, if you use this relation in the thermal equation, and if you integrate again, because you know this integral here, you put the result here, and you obtain simply the balance of the burned gas temperature minus the initial temperature, which is simply the mass multiplied by the specific heat per unit mass, which is simply the heat release per unit mass by the reaction, which is the heat release per unit mass of reactant times the mass fraction of the reactant in the initial mixture. All right? Is that clear? Okay. Now, I will use the simplest Arrhenius law. I will use an Arrhenius law such that this rate is proportional to the first power of the mass fraction. You may put any power you like. The solution is very similar, but to simplify, for the sake of simplicity, I will use linear relation this is said to a first order reaction. If you put square, it is a second order reaction, and so on. And now I use that reaction rate here is the Arrhenius law that I have described to you in my first lecture. All right? And I will introduce the reaction rate at the burned gas temperature, which is a faster one, as you know, because it is an exponential growth. It grows exponentially with the temperature. And so now, because when I introduce this reaction rate at the burned gas, okay, I put that, and I will have the difference here between 1 over T divided by 1 over TB here, okay? And this, if I introduce T minus T, if I introduce now the reduced temperature, which is T minus initial temperature divided by the temperature of the burned gas minus the temperature initially. This quantity, this scalar, it is a scalar, theta, it goes from 0 to 1. It is 0 when in the initial mixture, it is 1 in the burned mixture. All right? So this is more easy to use this scalar. And then when I put this expression in it here, I have the difference of minus exponential 1 over kb fraction 1 over t minus 1 over tb. I develop this, and I have 1 over t on denominator, and I have beta 1 minus theta, which is where this beta is here. So this is a matter of algebra, simple algebra. The only point which makes some difficult technical difficulty is that you have here the temperature T on the denominator here of the exponent. And this makes an expression in theta which is more complicated than simply beta 1 minus theta. But because we are going to work in the large activation energy limit, this term T is not essential because this term, the reaction rate, is negligible everywhere except at the highest temperature. So when T equals TB. So this is going to disappear. This ratio is going to disappear from this expression. This is more clear now in the second, in the next slide. Okay, now I following Zeldovich and Frank Kamineski, I will use a simplification. I will use a unity Lewis number. This, I am going to use the fact that the diffusion, thermal diffusivity is equal to molecular diffusivity. It turns out that in a gas, it is a good, if there is not too much difference of mass between the inert gas, the inert component, it's a very good, and the reactant, it is a very good approximation. For gas, all the diffusion coefficients are close, very close. So to simplify the problem, I will use that this number, which is called the Lewis number, which is the ratio of the two diffusivity, is equal to one. Why it is so? It is important to put that. Because, and I have introduced now theta is the reduced temperature, and I will use psi, the reduced mass fraction. The reduced mass fraction, when y equal yu in the fresh mixture is one, and in the burned gas it is zero. Okay? So now here are the equation. You know, for the moment I did not put Lewis number equal to one. This is the form of the equation for theta, which is written here. And this is the form of the equation for psi, the mass fraction, the reduced mass fraction. And as I told you, these equations are quite similar, except the minus sign here, because you are consuming the reactant, and the plus sign here, because you are producing it, because the reaction is exothermal. You produce energy. So these equations are quite similar, and the beta here, the beta that I have used here is here. I have, for the moment, I keep TB over T of our unity. Now, let's consider Lewis number equal to one. If you have Lewis number equal to one, these equations are exactly similar, except for a minus sign. They are exactly the same. So in that case, psi, if you add these two equations, you find that psi plus theta is constant. And because of the boundary condition, psi is 1 minus theta. So if you put 1 minus theta instead of psi in the reaction rate, now you end up with a single ordinary differential equation, second order, but ordinary differential equation, one scalar, theta, and a reaction rate here, which is a nonlinear expression in terms of theta. Where is the nonlinearity? It is in the temperature. Forget about this T here, it is going to disappear. So when beta is large, now because of this exponential here, minus beta 1 minus theta, these terms go to zero except if theta is close to one. All right? This was the genius of Zeldovich to notice that. And here this picture is tells you exactly how it works. You know, this is a profile of the temperature, right, in red here. And here is a reaction rate. This reaction rate here is non-negligible. Is non-negligible only when beta 1 minus theta is of order unity, which means that theta is close to 1. Okay? So you have a boundary layer here, which is called the reaction zone, which is close to theta equal 1, you know, this is 1 over beta is here, all right? And because here I have the slope here, which is given, as you will see, by the external solution, this layer here, the of the dr, it is called dr, you see that? Dr means thickness of the reaction rate, is in fact much smaller than the total thickness. In other words, if you plot this omega prime theta here, I forget this because t is close to tb, this is my omega prime here. In terms of theta, I have zero everywhere because when 1 minus theta is of order unity and beta goes to infinity, goes to zero. The only way to have something different from zero, from beta goes to infinity, is to have 1 minus theta of order 1 over beta, very small. So you see, this is very clear. You have the reaction rate is concentrated in the hot part of the flame. Now, Zeldovich, this is a picture of Zeldovich. Now, this is the same thing as I have said. Now, he noticed the following. He said, okay, now my flame structure in this simple model, I will tell you later on how these ideas are developed for much more complicated model. In this simple model, the flame structure is the following. You have a thick zone where the reaction rate is zero. Here, this is what we call the preheated zone. And this, in this preheated zone, you may solve this equation because it is a constant coefficient. And you can integrate once. When you integrate once and you integrate twice, you obtain that theta is going exponential minus exponential m x divided by rho dt is an exponential of that. And I have put here the origin of x equals zero at the reaction layer. So x minus infinity is the fresh mixture. So in the fresh mixture, x going to infinity, theta is going to zero because x is minus infinity on that side. This is a solution. Alors, why? In fact, in this solution, I have put at the origin, I have put theta equal 1. Why did I do that? Because simply, as this picture tells you, that close to theta equal 1, close to the reaction rate, theta equal 1. And the difference is of order 1 over beta. If I neglect this 1 over beta, I have here my solution in the external zone. Now, it's easy to compute now the flux coming out from this zone, or if you want, the flux that you have in the preheated zone, which is simply the heat flux, and I look to this heat flux at the reaction boundary layer here, which is equal to when you have theta equal 1, and this gives you m. So I know the flux, heat flux, which is entering in the preheated zone, coming from the reaction zone. This I know, because I have solved this problem of the external solution. Now, this flux should be equal to the flux that is leaving the reaction zone. So I have to solve the reaction zone. If I was not lucky, I could not have to solve this. I could not know how to solve this reaction, except if there is a simplification. You know, here, why I was able to solve the preheated zone is because I have a simplification. The reaction, the nonlinear term is zero. So this is easy to solve. Now, I hope it is clear that I cannot get rid of the reaction term in the reaction zone. But this is nonlinear. Dangerous to solve a problem which is nonlinear. Ah. Okay. Now, here are the order of magnitude analysis. Once again, you will see. This is very important. I am looking, I have three terms. Convective term, diffusive term, reaction rate. What I know that in my reaction zone, the temperature variation delta theta is 1 over beta. So the derivative of this, because dt over dx should be the variation of theta divided by the thickness, and the thickness is dr, and I have used here the expression of m that I have written here. So this is the order of magnitude of the convective flux, m d theta over dx, one term of the equation. The other term is the diffusion term. Diffusion term is of second order derivative, so it should be divided by the square of the detonation, of the reaction thickness, all right? And multiplied by delta theta, which is 1 over beta, times rho b dtb, which is the diffusion coefficient at the value at the hot gas. And now, if I look to the reaction rate, it is psi, which is theta, delta theta, which is 1 over beta, rho b divided by tau rb, which is a reaction rate, 1 over TRB, is a reaction rate at the burn temperature. So here are the full equations that I am going to solve, and here are the different. Now, I am going to assume that, as I notice on this picture, that dr, the thickness of the reaction zone, is small compared to the total thickness. So I am going to assume that dr is small in front of dl. So in that case, this term here should be negligible in front of this one, because the ratio of this is exactly dr divided by dl, which is the ratio of the laminar flame thickness, or the inverse, the reaction zone. You see, compare these two terms here. You see, the difference of these two terms is the ratio dr over dl. In one, you have dr squared. In the other, on the denominator, you have dr dl. So this term should be negligible in the reaction rate. This is a key point. The key point is that I have a simplification of the reaction, which is written here. And now, it is not very difficult, when you know how to do it, as usual, to solve this problem. It's not very difficult to solve it. Here, what I did, I multiply this equation by d theta over dx. Okay? So d theta over dx times the second derivative of theta over dx is 1/2 d over dx squared. D theta over dx squared. Okay? Now on the right hand side, I have multiplied by d theta over dx. Now I may integrate this across this reaction zone. And it is easy. Why? Because here I have d theta over dx. When I integrate over dx, I just have to integrate the function in terms of theta by theta. And now the theta. So now I have this expression, and if I use this variable here, beta 1 minus theta, now I go from, this theta is going from beta from 0 to beta 1 minus theta, theta minus theta d theta, and this is 1. This quantity is 1 when theta goes to infinity. So theta goes to infinity, to be more clear, beta 1 minus theta go to minus infinity. So go to infinity. This go to infinity, okay? So in the fresh mixture. So, because theta decreases from 1, beta goes to infinity, this goes to infinity. So this is the key point. Now, because you know exactly from the taking the square root of that, you know the flux that is going out from this reaction layer, which is a boundary layer, in fact, this boundary layer. So you have the slope, you find out the slope of theta outside the boundary layer. When you get out on this side here, it is zero. It is zero. And on this side, beta 1 minus theta is going to infinity. So you have to integrate. And this is a number now. And this number is unity. So you have this term equal to 1 over beta squared when you are getting out from this boundary layer. And now this gives you a heat flux, and this heat flux should be the one which is obtained from the downstream entrance of the external zone. So this is the flux going out, which is given by this equal to 1 over beta squared here. And this is the flux that I have computed in the previous slide for the flux in the print zone. And I have to match these two flux, and I obtain immediately, when matching, saying that this is equal to that with the, be careful with the rho b here, will you obtain this expression for the mass flux. But the max flux is rho u time flame velocity. So this is an expression of the flame velocity. So it is very interesting to see what is the difference now, if you use this expression of dr here, you obtain that the ratio of the flame thickness by the thickness of the reaction zone by the thickness of the flame is 1 over beta. You obtain that the ratio of these two thickness is 1 over beta. Now, it is interesting to compare this result here with the result that I have presented to you in my first lecture obtained by dimensional analysis. What is the difference? The difference is, there are two differences. One is that on the left-hand side, you have here rho u, u l. And now you have here rho b times square root. Square root of what? Not exactly this, but you have a beta square term in it. And this you cannot guess from dimensional analysis, because beta is a non-dimensional number, and you cannot guess what is the power that you are going to obtain in the final answer. So this is the final answer obtained by Zeldovich. This is a wonderful piece of work, and it is so wonderful, so difficult to understand, that, let me tell you, and I will finish that. I don't remember at what time I have to finish. A quarter to ten? Yeah, a quarter, okay, so I have a quarter of hour. You should be tired, Amor, no, but okay. I am not tired, but I am afraid that you are tired, because these are subtle. I can tell you it is subtle. It is not difficult to understand. It is subtle. Technically, there is no asymptotic, complicated mathematical formula. If you read the paper of Zeldovich, 4 pages, there is no word about asymptotic analysis. It is almost what I said. But I changed a little bit because he was even less detailed than I told you. But he is by that. Now, Why this is so difficult to understand? It is so difficult to understand that at the same time, exactly at the same time, 38, another great scientist that you have heard of, Kolmogorov, was looking to a similar problem. You see this problem? Exactly. This is reduced in the non-dimensional form, but it is the same problem. Second order differential equation on the left, non-linear term on the right. But he was not looking to convergence. He was looking to propagate in the original work of Kolmogorov, Pitsunov, Petrovsky. This is very not easy to read. Eh? This one is a pure mathematical problem. It's at the difference of Zeldovich, it is pure mathematical problem, and it is difficult to read. It took me some time to understand what was behind it. And they look to the same type of equation, but with a different production rate. There was an American, Fisher, I think he was American, who wrote this equation at that time for the propagation of genes on that. So for in biology. For this equation is an archetype equation for the propagation of wave in biology or population growth, for example. You know, how a population develop, you know, how a forest develop, you know, how a forest that start here, how it grows in time, right? This kind of equation. This is called a reaction diffusion equation. And what is fabulous is that for this problem, they are going to find a quite different solution than that of Zeldovich. Quite different. And these two scientists, it took 15 years before one of them, Zeldovich, tried to understand where the difference was coming from. You know, this is to tell you that it's not a question of technical, mathematical difficulty or technical difficulty. It's a question of understanding. And I'll try to make you understand the difference. I am not sure I will succeed because this is difficult. This is the same problem. Working in the reference frame of the front, I use mu for the frame speed now because it is reduced frame speed. I have to solve this equation here. This is a diffusion equation plus or with an external nonlinear term. Here, now, if you look to a wave propagating from one theta equal 1 to theta equal 0, this is a wave equation. Now, like in the one I have just discussed before. But the problem is that they were using two types of nonlinear terms. And first of all, they are considering smooth nonlinear terms. What does that mean, smooth? That means that the reaction rate is not singular. It is, for example, they used typically as in the original paper, Kolmogorov used this reaction rate. That go from zero to zero in a smooth way because it is quadratic. So it is something like that. You know, you see the difference with the conversion. Conversion, it is like that. All right? So they use a very smooth, and the answer is very different. There is a transition in the solution when you go from here, from such a simple thing, to it is easy to build a model for that. I did that with Linian. in 82, I think. And Zeldovich also looked to this problem, but in a much more complicated thing. But we got some interesting result. So let me tell you. The things are going a little bit more complicated for those who do not like mathematics. You know, now I will change variable. I will use a capital X for theta. You will see why. And I will use capital Y for the derivative of theta times mu. Here is the original equation, with I am looking for mu that go from 0 to 1 with a reaction rate which is similar to this one. Okay? Now, if you, maybe you know that when you have a second order differential equation, it is interesting to reduce that to a first order differential equation by working in the space of parameter derivative function, phase space. This mathematician calls that phase space. But okay, you do that, and here is the equation that you have. And the equation now takes this form. And if you divide this by this, you have first order differential equation with a nonlinear term. You know, you express y in terms of x. This for those who study statistical physics, did you have course in statistical physics? No? Okay. This is what we do in statistical physics immediately, you know, or in quantum mechanics. You do not use impulsion and position, you consider that as two independent variables. This is what is doing here, okay? And if you do that, you transform this second order differential equation and first order differential equation. And now, this, what you are going to do is to linearize the problem around the two limits, 0 and 1, or x. So it turns out it turns out that you can look for a solution in the form of an exponential, and you will find and put that in this equation, and you linearize here this omega prime here. And yeah, this is a linear equation here, linearized. And you see that if you put an exponential in it, you have a second order differential equation for the small r, the low capital R that is here. And this second order equation, you can solve it. So you find, in that case, you find the form, all the possible form of the solution of the trajectory in the phase space near the two points O and 1. These points are singular in the because the ratio here, the numerator and the denominator is 0. It is 0 divided by 0. This is why we call that, mathematician calls that, singular point. But when you do that, you find out all the possible solution trajectory around this point. So because y is mu dx, you have this k. This is the eigenvalue. R are called the eigenvalue. K I call the eigenvector. And now you will have different scenarii in the phase space. For it, start with the case of the equilibrium. Okay, you have an equilibrium state in x equal 1, which is in the Born gas, if you like. Equilibrium case means what? Means that this term, this coefficient here, must be negative in such a way that this equation here, give you a relaxation toward the equilibrium state. So just so in that case, this term is negative. Omega prime theta is negative at the equilibrium state. Now assume that the initial state is also stable, but it should be stable or metastable. What does that mean? Excuse me. You know, here it is. This is a solution where you are stable. This is a potential, which is the derivative of the reaction rate. This is a case where you are metastable, because if you have a fluctuation sufficiently high to overcome this bump, you go down here. So, but this is unstable, for example. This is a case of flame. Flame is unstable. It's weakly unstable. Okay. I will finish. I won't. Now, if you assume that the initial state is a metastable state or an equilibrium state, and the final state is an equilibrium state, you obtain this expression for the eigenvalue. One is negative, the other is positive, and one is negative, the other is negative in both. So any trajectory that is leaving the saddle should come to the saddle, and he has no choice. He should arrive by this. There is only one possible direction, because you assume that theta has to be positive. So it turns out that now, that you can do that on your computer, for example. It's easy to do on the computer. This is tir corrigé. How do you say that in English? Tir corrigé. Professor Poinceau, help me.
I'm not sure.
Okay. Okay, you have to start from here. You know how to start, and you adjust mu in order to reach this point by this direction. If mu is not good, you are going this way and you finish here. If it is, you are going on this way back, and this is zero, and so on. So there is only one value of mu which is going to work. So in that case, okay, you are only value of u, but this value is quite different than the value obtained by Zelovich. We will see why. Now, assume that the initial state is unstable, and the final state is stable, that it should be. Now, if it is unstable, you have this. You have the two eigenvalues are positive, and one is larger than the other. What does that mean? When you look to this exponential, and when you go to psi to minus infinity, the one which is you have a lot many trajectories are going to this trajectory, except one, which corresponds to the R plus A plus equals zero. And in one, you arrive along this non-degenerated trajectory. You see this, and now what does that mean? When you start from here, it's easy to find up a value of mu that is going to zero, because there are many, many trajectories going through the degenerate direction here. So it's not surprising that you have an infinite number of solutions of this problem, but a very one which is very particular here. You know, it's just a geometrical fact, if you like. If you are in the case where omega prime theta equals zero, positive, and where this term is imaginary, now you have what is called a focus, because the eigenvalue R, no more gas. Ah, no. Okay, it's time to finish. Because this term is imaginary. This term is imaginary here. And so now you have what is called a focus. So you have to reject this solution because they go to the theta equals zero, x equals zero, excuse me, going by negative value of x, and this is forbidden. So to summarize, when you have an unstable medium, you will have a continuous set of possible solution with a minimum value. And the minimum value is going to one scenario is this minimum value is correspond to this square root equals zero. Because after that, below this minimum, you go the origin is a focus, and so you reach the origin by the negative quantity, and you have to reject this. You know, if theta is a mass fraction, it cannot be negative. That's impossible. So it turns out this is a wonderful solution obtained by Kolmogorov for this problem. He told you that the minimum value is easy to obtain. It is this one. But this, and now, more recently, people show that this minimum value is the one which is obtained asymptotically in time for the unsteady version of the problem. And but I will skip this because this is difficult. Huh? This is difficult. So this is, in fact, this all the physical solution is the minimum solution. It is the one, when you start with an initial condition, the tails here are propagating with the minimum velocity here. But what is surprising, that this lower bound, which is selected by the long time limit, is not at all the Zeldovich solution. Remember, the Zeldovich solution is an integral of omega. It's not the square root of the derivative of omega. So, who is right? Who is wrong? So, Zeldovich. This is, I gave you, but I will skip that now. I gave you a simple explanation why this minimum value is obtained as an asymptotic value in time, starting with an initial problem. So you see, there is a difference of the Kolmogorov solution and the Zeldovich solution. You see, they have nothing to do. They have really nothing to do. They are quite different. Zeldovich realized that maybe it was in the 50-something. So 10 years later, he began to read what Kolmogorov was doing. And he wondered why it is so different. But the result is the following. Is that this solution, there is a transition in the scenario, in the phase space, when you go from a soft to a stiff. Here, it's not difficult to build a thing to that. And you show that when beta is increasing, and I developed that with Linian in 1984, it's not difficult to show that there is a transition in the scenario when the beta increases. And what is the transition? Let me show you. The transition is written here. That for Zeldovich, for the Kolmogorov solution, the minimum corresponds to this term equals zero, means that the two eigenvalues here collapse. This is the minimum value obtained by Kolmogorov. And the minimum value, the value obtained by Zeldovich corresponds to the particular trajectory which arrived by the non-degenerate case here, which occur before that the two collapse. Because after that, after this red one, you go from the back. So when you have understood that, you have understood the difference. And this is why this problem is so complicated from a mathematical point of view, is that the scenario is different for a soft nonlinear term than from a stiff nonlinear term. And the genius of Zeldovich was to realize that combustion corresponds to a stiff nonlinear problem, so stiff that it is singular. You know. So this is, so I have finished. Thank you very much for your attention.